Buckingham Palace, the epicentre of British monarchy. But behind its gilded gates lie hundreds upon hundreds of secrets.
If the walls could speak, they would have some wonderful stories to tell.
From a theft inside a princess's bedroom...
It was a crime. A member of staff had stolen these.
...to an armed and dangerous royal.
In World War II, the Queen Mother used to use rats as target practice.
Even the palace's beautiful treasures hold incredible secrets.
The royal collection is just stunning. And every sculpture, every vase is precious and priceless.
In this programme, royal insiders reveal what really goes on inside this spectacular home. From palace chefs...
The Queen has a royal menu book that is completed by the chef. She puts a line through the dishes that she doesn't want.
To royal party planners...
The Queen has to have a secret passage. She can't trail through miles and miles of corridors with people gawping at her.
And royal appointed photographers...
I said, excuse me, ma'am, but there is one very important picture missing. And she went, goodness me, how we've missed that, how we missed that.
These are the secrets of Buckingham Palace. It's one of the most famous buildings on Earth. But Buckingham Palace is also a family home. And at the heart of every home is the kitchen. With shelves stacked with saucepans dating back 200 years, an army of around 20 royal chefs prepare food and drink throughout the day. Starting with the Queen's morning routine. It's 7:30 a.m., the kitchen's first task of the day, the royal cuppa.
She only drinks Earl Grey, no milk, no sugar.
The Queen doesn't make her own tea. She has a special coffee room. They make all the teas and coffees. But she would actually pour her own tea when she was eating breakfast on her own.
All food created in the royal kitchens is overseen by the Queen.
The Queen has a royal menu book that's completed by the chef, and the chef does 3 days' menus, and that gives us enough time to get all the produce in and prepare it. And when the menu book goes up to the Queen, she puts a line through the dishes that she doesn't want.
She has a HP pencil, and she'd tick one or add something that she would prefer.
If she's out for dinner, she puts a line through the page. And if she's got guests coming, she'll put two or three, so we know that she's entertaining.
The Queen has particular tastes that a chef ignores at his peril.
She knows what she likes. Nothing too spicy, because she meets that many people. The last thing she wants, I can smell garlic in my breath, or last night's curry.
The Queen doesn't eat garlic, and the Queen doesn't serve garlic, because the Queen is concerned that garlic clings to the being, and you can smell it on the breath.
If food is offered out of season, heads will roll.
You try and serve strawberries to the Queen in January, and it's off to the tower. You're really in trouble.
9 a.m., and it's time for breakfast.
Typical breakfast for the Queen would be in her own sitting room. She'd have some hot tea and then a bowl of cereals from a plastic Tupperware container.
It might have been served on a silver tray in, you know, lovely porcelain, but it was still kept in Tupperware containers, just like in anyone else's kitchen back at home.
Prince Charles has a very particular breakfast routine as well.
Whenever the Prince of Wales came to stay with the Queen, he always arrived with that hamper of his own produce. And in the kitchen, we'd have jars of bottled plums from the Highgrove Garden. The instructions were to put two plums and a little juice into the bowl and send it in to him for breakfast. I'd send in two plums and he would take one, so they'd come back out after breakfast and I'd put the other plum back into the jar and save it. So one morning I thought, okay, he only eats one for breakfast, so I just put one plum in the jar and sent it out into the dining room. And the footman came through and said, His Royal Highness said, can he have two, please? So I had to keep sending two in every morning.
The dozens of chefs and butlers aren't the only inhabitants of one of Buckingham Palace's busiest rooms. For all the palace's pomp and grandeur, it's been hiding a secret for centuries. A secret it would very much like to get rid of. Rats.
Buckingham Palace has definitely got a rat problem. When Queen Victoria moved to Buckingham Palace as Queen, she was shocked by how many rats there were. The rats treated Buckingham Palace like their own personal playground, and when Victoria moved in, she tried to put a stop to it, and really, it ended up being a bit of a battle. It got so bad that Victoria had to appoint her own rat catcher. And this was Jack Black, whose title was VR, Rat and Mole Catcher to Her Majesty. And he really was the rat whisperer. I think that Victoria really hoped that he would exterminate the rats for good. But I'm afraid he didn't. The rats continued to plague Buckingham Palace throughout the reigns of all the monarchs. And in World War II, the Queen Mother used to use the rats as target practice. So she had a gun and she was practicing for what to do in case Hitler invaded and she was kidnapped. She got the gun and she used to shoot them in the ruins of this crumbled part of Buckingham Palace. So the rats have always been a problem throughout all of Buckingham Palace. As recently as 2019, exterminators were called in because rats were seen tearing through the royal kitchens. I honestly think that the best place to be in London if you're a rat is Buckingham Palace. There's lots of food, there's lots of hidden places, there's lots of holes because it's such an old house. So rats have a good time in Buckingham Palace, and they historically always have. So if you ever you go to a state banquet, you never know, there might be a couple of rats lurking under the floorboards.
The public face of the palace is, of course, rather grander. And the look and style of this royal residence is down to a collection of monarchs throughout the centuries.
Architecturally, Buckingham Palace started off as a very beautiful house, arguably the most beautiful in England, and it gradually got worse.
Built for the Duke of Buckingham at the end of the 17th century, it became a royal residence when George III bought it in 1761, transforming it into the palace that is still visible from the garden.
This great spread has engulfed old Buckingham House.
For his granddaughter, Queen Victoria, the existing palace wasn't enough, so she added a huge new wing in front of it.
You end up with something which is a monster, frankly.
The next to have a tinker was George V. He decided to fix the bodge job by adding a new facade of Portland stone, creating the palace we see today.
Scaffolding came down summer 1913, blistering bright stone, new Baroque palace. The royals had the appearance, the semblance of a great European power, finally.
It was Victoria who made the first public appearance on that famous balcony. A tradition that caught on.
It is a focal point where people can gather and watch and wait for news.
Greater and greater crowds surge around the palace railings as onto the balcony come the royal family, accompanied by our Prime Minister himself.
VE Day, the ending of the war, everything has always been focused on the balcony.
Of course, so many iconic moments, whether it's, you know, the kiss after Charles and Diana's wedding.
The crowd called, "Kiss her, kiss her." So that's the first public royal kiss.
I think my favourite has got to be at the wedding of Kate and William, where William's three-year-old goddaughter, Grace Van Cutsem, was seen to be holding her hands to her ears in horror and looking down at the huge crowds and the noise they were making.
More recently, the Queen slightly admonished the Duke of Cambridge because during the balcony appearance at Trooping the Colour, he was bending down talking to George, and we don't do that. We maintain not necessarily rigid attention, but upright so that the public can see you and no fiddling around.
In contrast to the pomp and circumstance of state events, the royals' private apartments are relatively humble.
think I was going to interview Prince Edward or something. So I went up in this rickety old-fashioned lift, like a really old-fashioned hotel, sort of wire lift, clanking the way up. And then I noticed when I got out, they had these very, very long corridors. And there was a sort of toy horse, a sort of pushing horse. And I thought, God, I wonder if that ever belonged to the Queen.
It's not just the interior of the building that can seem a little dilapidated. In some places, the outside is crumbling away.
Bits of masonry falling off the parapet of the roof. I saw a piece narrowly miss the Princess Royal quite a number of years ago.
It'd be too embarrassing if a bit of masonry fell onto the head of a treasured head of state. And even more embarrassing if it fell onto the head of state who nobody liked.
Perhaps it's no surprise the Queen is rumoured not to be fond of her giant disintegrating home.
It's a very institutional building. None of them likes it, including not the Queen.
No, it's not true the Queen doesn't like Buckingham Palace. It is just that it is part of the job, goes with the territory, she is head of state, and she lives at Buckingham Palace when she's working in London.
Coming up, the incredible origins of the Buckingham Palace piano.
This is a piano that has been completely blinged up. It's OTT.
And we reveal the palace's secret rooms hidden from public view.
There used to be a staff bar. It was got rid of a few years ago because the staff were getting a little bit worse for wear.
Buckingham Palace, one of the most lavish buildings in the world, both outside and in. Made up of nearly 800 rooms, including 19 stunning staterooms and a flush 78 bathrooms. Over the years, many of these lush interiors have been decorated with the royal family's extensive art collection.
It's not just paintings, it's pieces of jewellery. It's furniture, but it is incredibly valuable because it's a reflection of the personal taste of the kings and queens of the last 400 years.
And one of the most exquisite items is this grand piano, which can be seen at Buckingham Palace in the Queen's white drawing room.
It is not your average piano. This is a piano that has been completely blinged up, pimped up. It's OTT, it is gold, it is covered in decoration. It's a really exquisite piece.
It was commissioned by Queen Victoria in 1856 to be the showpiece of their staterooms at Buckingham Palace.
It's a bit of a composite piece. The actual piano, the keys, the workings of it, are by a company known as Erard. And they were very important piano makers during the Victorian period. The casing is actually from an earlier piano. It's made up of so many rich materials. There's mahogany, satinwood. It's all been varnished, gilded. And the miniatures painted on it are by a French miniaturist called Rochard.
Its ownership and history makes this piano one of the most valuable musical items in the royal collection.
Well, other similar Erard pianos have sold at auction for £140,000, around that mark. But because this has been played by every monarch from Queen Victoria onwards, surely just that provenance would whack up the price tag.
For Albert and Victoria, their love of music was invaluable. And piano playing was one of their favourite pastimes, here at Buckingham Palace or in any of their palaces.
Music was such an important part of their relationship. They were both excellent musicians, they both played the piano. Victoria had a beautiful soprano voice. It really is amazing to think that this object has had all these royals performing the music, the cutting-edge music of their time, on its keys.
Though it's not known, if our current queen plays the piano in any of her palaces. We do know it featured prominently in her 2018 Christmas message, where it can clearly be seen in the background.
Our current queen, Elizabeth II, got into a bit of trouble with this piano. In her speech, she was talking about generosity, about giving to one another. And yet in the background, there is hundreds of thousands of pounds worth of gilded pianos. It sort of undermined the message slightly.
Whatever the price tag, for the royal family, the piano is simply part of the furniture of Buckingham Palace.
This piano has been played by every monarch from Queen Victoria right up to our present queen. There's a photograph of her mum, the Queen Mum, playing to George VI on their 25th wedding anniversary. I think it's quite a romantic object.
Behind the palace gates, this royal home is a hive of activity, with over 800 staff reportedly working here. And these workers make use of some of the palace's most exclusive and secret rooms.
There's a post office, there's a chapel, there is a doctor's surgery that's actually kitted out for genuine surgical procedures if there's an emergency.
It's a swimming pool. When I was working there, I used it regularly, I used it every day, but then I gave up after a while because Princess Margaret used to use it.
There's a Coutts ATM in the basement, should the Queen ever decide she does need to carry cash.
There used to be a staff bar. It was got rid of a few years ago because the staff were getting a little bit worse for wear during the course of the day.
Luckily, Her Majesty has ways of avoiding her squiffy servants.
I remember once watching the Queen walking towards what I thought was a mirror and a table, and thinking, what's going to happen? You know, what's she going to do? And as she walked up to it, it opened and through she went.
Behind the mirror, a genuine secret passageway, leading to the Queen's private apartments.
The Queen has to have a secret passage. She can't trail through miles and miles of corridors with people gawping at her.
On that side table that's attached to the mirror, all the ornaments and so on are glued on, so nothing will fall off as the door is opened.
Buckingham Palace is the most recognisable of all the Queen's royal palaces. And this building holds hundreds of secrets inside its walls. But one of its most stunning is found just outside the palace gates.
When you approach Buckingham Palace, it's not the palace itself that's the first thing to hit you. Instead, there is an enormous marble sculpture, and it is dripping with iconography.
This is the Victoria Monument, a tribute to one of Britain's longest reigning queens, created by her son, Edward VII.
When Edward VII came to the throne in 1901, he set up a committee to consider a fitting memorial to his mother, Queen Victoria.
She'd been on the throne for so long. She'd been the only queen that many people had known. And during her reign, the most extraordinary revolutions had taken place, not only industrially, but also politically. England coming to dominate the world economically and territorially.
To pay tribute to his mother, Edward chose the architect Aston Webb and the sculptor Thomas Brock, and they came up with this.
It's a whopper. It stands 25 metres tall and contains 2,300 tonnes of Italian Carrara marble. And that marble conveys a lot of symbolism.
Surrounding Victoria are also images that depict justice and truth, elements that the architect wanted to associate with her 63-year-long reign. But the silent sculpted messages don't stop there.
Around the edge, further still, in bronze, are figure groups to do with manufacture and agriculture and peace and progress. And on top of this scene, we have the crowning figure of victory. Like the cherry on the cake, she stands gilded, holding up a wreath. telling everyone who sees this monument that the figure beneath, Queen Victoria, will be crowned with laurel for eternity. The memorial is very visible and familiar to millions of people, but here's the secret to it. It's not just those 2,300 tons of Carrara marble, and it's not just the plinth that it sat on, because the concept for it extends much further out. It encompasses everything we see here at the end of the Mall, because it is the entire forecourt to Buckingham Palace.
It represents in many ways the reach of Victoria's reign across the globe, and here was a legacy that was established through a remodeling of central London, really, which was going to endure and show how profound and significant Victoria's reign and legacy was.
Edward knew that the cost of this ambitious project would be huge, an estimated £27 million in today's money. To fund it, he lobbied Victoria's empire.
Those contributions were recognised in the designs of these gates. You can see the names of countries, South Africa, West Africa opposite, there's Canada and Australia.
But what many people don't know is that Edward's fundraising was so successful that there was a huge cash surplus that also needed to be spent.
So £60,000 was diverted into the recasing of Buckingham Palace's facade, turning what had been a dull, lacklustre design into something befitting London and its imperial status.
The palace went from this to the building we recognise today. The whole project took over 10 years and was finally completed in the autumn of 1913. And since its creation over 100 years ago, the Victorian Monument and Buckingham Palace have been the setting and focus for many royal and national celebrations. Coming up, how one queen transformed this royal residence into a party palace.
Queen Victoria is not impressed by what she finds. She wants glitz, she wants glamour.
And a royal photographer reveals the secrets of a palace photo shoot.
I said, excuse me, ma'am, but there is one very important picture missing. And she went, goodness me, how have we missed that, how have we missed that?
Buckingham Palace. The royal family's most famous home has been transformed over the years. It has been a concert venue, the location for the world-famous garden parties, and incredibly, it has also been a makeshift maternity ward. It was here in 1948 the Queen gave birth to her first child.
When she had Prince Charles, the Queen actually had a cesarean section. She wasn't rushed to hospital. The royal doctors set up an operating theatre inside Buckingham Palace. Everything was sterilised and performed the operation so that she could have Prince Charles there and then.
And if you thought her consort would have been there to support her, think again.
Apparently, Prince Philip was swimming and playing squash when Prince Charles is born, which, frankly, is about as useful as a man can be at these events, so he probably did entirely the right thing.
Philip was around for the birth of his youngest child.
By that time, it's thought that the Queen put a lot of pressure on him and said modern fathers and modern husbands are at their wives' bedside during the birth now, so you jolly well can be too.
The head obstetrician was Sir John Peel, Ingrid Seward's godfather. Only one secret about the delivery ever escaped his lips.
They converted the bull room in Buckingham Palace into an operating theatre. Normally, it's a guest suite for visiting heads of state. And it was all going a bit slowly, and the faces were very long. And Prince Philip walked in. And so, as it is Prince Philip's wont to make these kind of jokes, he said, "And to think that last week, General de Gaulle was having a bath in here." And that sort of broke the ice and everybody laughed.
Once the royal baby has arrived, one of the next key events is a christening photo shoot. In 1982, Buckingham Palace was the location for Prince William's baby snaps. Kent Gavin was the photographer handpicked by the palace to capture the event.
On arrival at the palace, I was given a list of the running order to which I could expect the photo call to take place. And the first one was Diana and Charles. And the only thing was that William's crying his eyes out. But Diana had the solution to that on and off during the photo call, and that was to put a little finger in his mouth. About 3 minutes had taken place before that picture was taken because of William hollering and hooting. But then, as it was like military clockwork, the Queen came out, Philip, Queen Mother, just sat down perfectly posed. It had all been organised and rehearsed for us. But it was William who was stealing the show, obviously, because of his crying. And normally we wouldn't have been present for those little pictures. This particular picture was the one that most of us ran on the front page. Many years later, William requested a copy of that picture, to which I sent him, and he sent me a very nice letter in reply. That was the last picture on the actual running order. And I walked across to the Queen. I said, "Excuse me, ma'am, but there is one very important picture missing, and that is the Queen Mother, the oldest and the youngest." And she went, goodness me, how we've missed that, how we missed that. And she called out, "Mother, Mother," and she sat down there. Diana handed William over, and that magic, yes, wonderful picture. Of course, the Queen was very grateful as well. She has a whole set of all of these pictures.
This vast palace contains many secrets. Some are found decorating its extravagant walls. Priceless artifacts accumulated by kings and queens through the centuries hold fascinating stories.
The royal collection is just stunning. It's extraordinary to walk around the palaces, and wherever you look, you are surrounded by the old masters, and every sculpture, every vase is precious and priceless.
Tucked away in one of the Queen's private rooms at Buckingham Palace are two pieces bought by George IV.
This beautiful pair of porcelain pheasants were made in 1815.
They've been made in a place called Jingdezhan in China, which was the centre, the greatest production centre of ceramics since the 14th century.
They're startlingly contemporary in a way. They're positioning with this upright thrust of the beaks. The way that the claw grips onto the stalk beneath, it's got a real dynamism to it, but it's also very stylized. And then just having that variegation of colour, the sort of shimmer of the different feathers alongside each other, I think they're really beautiful.
Now they peer over the Queen's shoulder at her visitors, as if they have always belonged there. But this wasn't the first royal palace that these birds were displayed in. They originally came from a different place, a forgotten palace kitted out by George IV.
Before the pheasants moved to Buckingham Palace around 1847, we know that they originally lived in Brighton Pavilion, because there's an etching made around 1820 that shows them on the mantelpiece.
This was the long gallery in a palace unlike any other, Brighton's Royal Pavilion.
The Brighton Pavilion was George IV's pet project, his passion project.
Created when he was Prince of Wales, Brighton Pavilion would be the perfect party palace.
You've got Chinese and Indian motifs, you've got Regency grandeur, you've got French influence and Gothic influence. It's this total mishmash of styles.
Brighton Pavilion can be considered as a piece of art in itself, a piece of art which Queen Victoria hated.
Victoria inherited Brighton Pavilion when she took the throne,
But she never really liked it. She said that the rooms were too dark, the ceilings were too low, and there really wasn't room for her ever-expanding family. Victoria ended up selling off Brighton Pavilion for just £53,000. She took all these beautiful objects out of Brighton Pavilion, and that is how the porcelain pheasants end up in Buckingham Palace.
The porcelain pheasants have been a permanent fixture at Buckingham Palace for over 170 years. Beautiful reminders of a long-lost royal pleasure palace.
They are a testament to how artworks have this long history and story all of their own.
Today, Buckingham Palace is undeniably Royal HQ, the place where the Queen gets her work done. But how did it become the grand focus of royal power? You have to go back to when George IV came to the throne. He became king when Britain was riding high after defeating Napoleon in the Battle of Waterloo.
England in 1820 was a country full of self-confidence. George wanted to consolidate this kind of sense of optimism and grandeur and power, and architecture is a way of displaying power, and Buckingham Palace really did sum up the age.
George spared no expense and employed one of the most fashionable and costly architects of the day, John Nash.
What George IV was hoping for was that Nash would give Buckingham Palace a real facelift.
And there is one particular room that Nash ensured would wow visiting dignitaries. The throne room. It has become the focal point for every milestone event in the royal family. From coronations to weddings, to meeting heads of state.
So the throne room at Buckingham Palace really overwhelms you. It batters your eyes with its throniness.
But despite George's extravagant spending on his pet palace, it wasn't finished within his lifetime. And the next king, William IV, did not share George's enthusiasm for palace building.
As a king, William wasn't interested in extravagance. He was a very austere figure, and he rejected the wealth, the splendour, the ceremony that had characterised his predecessor's reign.
And so it remained covered in dust sheets and getting increasingly dirty until Queen Victoria decided to move into it.
Victoria was the first monarch to live full-time at Buckingham Palace.
Yes, it was going to be the royal centre of operations, but it was really important for her that her family would be there and live with her too.
But she quickly decided that this fabulously appointed palace was nowhere near big enough for her growing family or her love of partying.
On arriving at Buckingham Palace, Queen Victoria is not impressed by what she finds. It's dirty, drab, it's cold. She wants glitz, she wants glamour. So she writes to Sir Robert Peel, requesting that the British government invest in a ballroom that she can use, where she can host her guests.
Buckingham Palace became a party palace in many ways.
The ballroom became not only the biggest in the palace, but also the largest in London.
The ballroom at Buckingham Palace is a whopper. It is 110 feet long, it's 60 feet wide, it's 45 feet high.
These huge proportions were needed for a particular reason.
The dance of the day was the waltz, and the waltz needed lots of space.
Victoria's husband, Prince Albert, took control of the project and added more and more ambitious ideas.
costs spiraled almost double the cost, about 77,000, which is about 6 million in today's money. Partly this was Albert sort of getting a bit carried away with installing things like gas lamps in the ballroom.
Even though the ballroom went way over budget, it was a huge success with its guests, leading the palace to be named the headquarters of taste. Coming up, the scandalous theft of secret love letters from inside the palace.
It was a crime. A member of staff had stolen these.
And how a tragic event at another royal residence transformed Buckingham Palace forever.
They come up with quite a pretty genius plan. What's extraordinary is that it was thought of by the Queen herself.
Buckingham Palace, one of the most magnificent royal palaces in the world. But behind the glitz and glamour, there are secrets that lurk within its corridors.
Well, if the walls could speak, they would have some wonderful stories to tell of intrigue, of betrayal, of love and thwarted love too.
Palatial royal scandals are, of course, not only consigned to ancient history. In 1989, one threatened to expose the state of Princess Anne's marriage when it was revealed that the protective walls of Buckingham Palace had been breached. Secret letters from Princess Anne's lover, Tim Lawrence, a member of the palace household, had been stolen from the princess's private apartments, and they had been sent straight to the newspapers.
One of the most unlikely secrets to emerge from the palace in recent years was the intimate letters written to Princess Anne by a man who at that time was the equerry to the Queen.
So these letters were leaked to the Sun newspaper, who clearly realised what dynamite they were sitting on.
But what the palace did next surprised even Fleet Street.
Ordinarily, what would happen is the newspaper goes to the Buckingham Palace, says, we've got some letters, we'd like to report on them. And Buckingham Palace would give a fairly anodyne blank statement just saying some letters have been stolen. That would be it.
But crucially, Buckingham Palace released a statement saying that the letters had been written by Queen's equerry Tim Lawrence to Princess Anne. And they were personal letters of a personal nature and they wouldn't be commenting further.
It was an astonishing bit of detail. As far as royal watchers were concerned, Buckingham Palace would never give you extra information when you go to them for a comment, ever. And so it was very widely seen as basically Princess Anne, or the royal family themselves as a whole, confirming this is the person she was in love with.
Fleet Street editors refused to publish the actual letters, claiming they were too steamy in nature and too hot to handle.
The letters were given to the Sun newspaper, who didn't publish them, crucially, because they couldn't. It would have been a breach of copyright, and the Sun knew that.
But aside from the palace's embarrassment, the letters also revealed a potential security risk at the palace.
How were they taken from Buckingham Palace? Who stole them, and what did they contain? The palace, the police, and the media are all anxious for the answers.
It was a crime. A member of staff had stolen these either from Anne's briefcase or her desk, but at the very least from her personal office, somewhere that very few people had access to.
It is a big deal, I mean, because the royal palaces are supposed to be the most secure buildings in the whole of the country.
I mean, if someone was able to pinch intimate love letters from one member of staff to one of the members of the royal family, well, what else could people pinch or go missing?
Of course, Metropolitan Police then had to launch an investigation, interviewing pretty much everybody who was at Buckingham Palace, hundreds and hundreds of people, taking all their fingerprints, taking their alibis, their stories, trying to work out who had stolen these letters.
The investigation also meant that Anne and Tim Lawrence were questioned.
I think the police were pretty nervous about that, as you would be, because you know you're going to be asking very delicate questions. In fact,
the reports back were that they were very open about it. And you can't help but think maybe they were relieved that it had got blown out into the open, that the choice had been taken away from them about how, when and if to go public. It had happened and everyone just had to deal with it.
The investigation continued for 4 months.
But the police could never come up with any explanation as to who was responsible. No one was ever charged.
They never found him or her, and it's still one of the palace's great secrets.
Buckingham Palace, like the monarchy itself, has evolved through the decades. The origins of its greatest change in recent years can be traced back to an event at the Queen's favourite residence, Windsor Castle.
It really does feel like you're in the monarch's home, much more so than Buckingham Palace, which is monarchy HQ. Windsor Castle is the home.
In 1992, fire consumed a large section of Windsor Castle, and the resulting repair bill ran into the millions. An economic recession and successive royal scandals had left the public unwilling to foot the bill. So, unknown to the public, the Queen took drastic action. Just 5 days after the fire, she convened a top-secret meeting of the most senior royals, herself, Prince Philip, and their adult children, plus 3 trusted private secretaries.
They come up with quite a pretty genius plan. Open up Buckingham Palace to the public. What's extraordinary about this genius plan is that it was thought of by the Queen herself. Even if her courtiers had thought of this as a way to raise money, I don't think they would have ever approached her on this.
On the 7th of August, 1993, the doors of the palace opened to the public for the very first time.
I was one of the first in the queue. Going into Buckingham Palace when their doors open and the flunkies invite you in is stepping over a genuine threshold, but into a world that we can only imagine.
You're not getting to see, you know, the Queen's private quarters, of course. You know, they are very much off limits. You're seeing the official staterooms that are used for entertaining.
But actually to go round the staterooms into the throne room, actually to look longingly at the throne and think, is anybody looking around? Can I go and sit on it?
In some ways, the reality was a bit of a shock.
Very grand, but it is also a very old building, and you very much do get that sense when you're inside.
I was expecting huge rooms, very impressive, intending to show power and glory and all the rest of it. And there was a lot of red and a lot of gold, but it was all tarnished and dusty. And it was clear there weren't enough staff around to keep it in pristine order.
But despite its scruffy appearance, the public flooded in.
Buckingham Palace is considered the most iconic royal palace across the globe. Sign me up is what people are thinking. These tickets sold out years in advance.
The original plan was to open for only a limited time, but the extraordinary demand made the royals reconsider.
And the tickets went hotcakes. What the Queen's realised is it's an absolute goldmine. I think it must have dawned on HM, who's an extremely shrewd investor, that we're onto a good thing here. And actually, if we keep doing it, we could get rid of those cobwebs. We could change those drapes. We might have real gold leaf up there again, as Victoria and Albert did. And I've been there to the Royal Palaces since. They look an awful lot smarter. They're cleaner. The toilets are modernised. Much better.
Turns out to have been a genius stroke to say that Buckingham Palace was to open. The disaster of the Windsor Castle fire, not only was it brilliantly reconstructed, you know, under budget and ahead of time, but the public ended up not paying. And something else happened, which was a terrific moment of openness, Buckingham Palace being somewhere that anybody could visit.
In a real sense, the monarchy was reborn from the ashes.
We feel much closer to the Queen now. We feel still in awe of the whole institution of monarchy. But I think the Queen has shown that you can change and that as you get older, you can get more innovative and probably richer.